Discuss briefly about Basel I. Basel I primarily and only focus on the capital adequacy ratio of a bank. Capital adequacy ratio or CAR actually helps to measure how better a bank is able to absorb the losses. So it is a ratio of how much capital a bank holds in comparison to the calculated risk. So this is the first step in the banking regulatory directions that helps investors to have a good confidence in the banking system and also to safeguard the depositors' money. So here the 8% cutoff was given as a percentage of risk weighted assets. Also, they have thoroughly discussed about the assets which a bank has and how much risk weight each asset has. So the first one is the cash. So how much cash a bank has with them. So as you know, that money is already of depositors and it is in liquidity with the bank. So that contains 0% risk. Any public sector debt which a bank gives in terms of buying bonds or anything, they gave it a risk weight of 10%. Some institutional banks like Development Bank, OECD banks, they gave it a measure of 20%. Mortgages was given a risk weight of 50%. And any kind of private sector debt like credit cards, real estate or any plant of equipment that was given 100% risk weighted percentage. Additionally, as it is a disclosure in terms of the for the banks, so banks are also required to report off balance sheet items such as letters of credits which have been issued, any commitments which they have already made but still they are unused, or any kind of derivative. So all in all, they wanted to factor all kinds of risk weighted assets into Basel I. So as we covered, from 1988 till early 2000s, Basel I was into the picture. Now, after being in place for almost 10 to 15 years, as the markets change, as the business problems change, the committee and the regulators and the banks understood there were some shortcomings in Basel I. So the most important shortcoming which was there in Basel was it only and only focused on credit risk. There are other types of risk also associated with the bank, as we studied earlier, like operational risk. So these kind of norms only partially prepared the bank in the event of a crisis. Also, the qualitative measures of different types of debtors, they were not able to take into account. So some debtors can be differentiated from others, say on the basis of their FICO scores or anything. These kinds of differences were not taken into account into Basel I. Also, what happens is when you book a credit, you give a book value, or at the time of the booking, what is the value of the credit. But as the time passes, the market value changes. So for example, a very quick example I can give is, when you will actually work on building models, you will see there is a booked FICO and there is a live to date FICO. So say I acquired a customer back in 2012. At that time, the customer was having a high FICO score of say 750. But as the time passed, the customer's financial condition deteriorated and its FICO score came down to, let's say, 660 or 680. So as a bank, I need to take point in time value, or exactly the present value of that customer, into account while deciding its risk exposure. So these kind of adjustments were not there in Basel I. So to cover that, Basel II came into picture, which was much more comprehensive and tried to overcome the shortcomings in Basel I. So there were very few regulations which were present in first accord and were removed in Basel II. So basically, mostly everything which was there in Basel I in terms of regulation was incorporated in Basel II as well, and there were multiple new additions, and the scope was also widened. Now, to increase the scope and make it more robust, the accord also provided the exact and accurate mathematical models that need to be used by the banks across globe. So now, any bank which is doing a Basel submission has to follow similar kind of methodology while they want to calculate their expected losses. This helped in standardizing the process, and if there were any banks who were trying to find any loophole in terms of using different kind of processes so that they can list up or list down their risk exposure, that possibility was also reduced. Also, as you know, the Basel I only included credit risk. Basel II also taken into account the market risk portion. So overall, if you see, and if you talk to anyone which talks about Basel II, the first question or they will be asking you, or first explanation they will be giving you, would be of three pillars. So three pillars are: first pillar consists of the capital controls or the minimum capital requirements that a bank should follow. Second is regulations for supervisory review. How can a supervisory body review this complete modeling process in a standardized manner? Also, as a third pillar of market discipline, it explained the banks how to run business in a efficient and a good governance scenario. Now let's talk about briefly each pillar by one. The first pillar, as we studied, is more about the capital regulation, the minimum capital requirements, and it included all three kinds of risk: credit risk, operational risk, and market risk. Guys, am I audible? Do let me know if you have questions. Okay. Okay, great. So, in terms of the first pillar, now because of Basel II, the banking industry moved to a more refined and specific requirements that they have to fulfill for the submissions to regulators. As a second pillar, which is more about supervisory review process, it supports pillar one. It also studies the dimension of risks that are not covered in the first pillar. For example, if there are any large exposures taken by the bank, any kind of particular credit concentration in one particular sector or type of customers, which a bank is doing right now, or any kind of strategic or business risk a business faces. Also, it tried to incorporate and study the factors which are external to the bank, like there are business cycles. Every economy or business goes through cycles of peaks and troughs. So they tried to cover those business cycles as well. And as you know, this is more about supervisory regulation. In second pillar, they gave guidelines how to ensure the pillar one compliance properly. So the first pillar tells you how to calculate the capital, but the second pillar is more like a monitoring mechanism of whether the banks are doing it properly or not. So these kind of monitoring mechanisms also very thoroughly explained. And the third pillar, which is of market discipline, it actually gave guidelines and tried to set standards for good corporate governance on. So this would help the investors and the depositors to have more confidence into the banking system and to increase the transparency so that they know where the banks are actually lying in terms of their business efficacy. So these include the requirements like banks have to disclose their details on the scope of application. They have to disclose their capital, their risk exposures. How do they assess their risk? All these kind of things they have to disclose, so that investors and depositors and thus whole economy has a confidence in those banks. So this was more about Basel II. Now, as you know, Basel II came in 2004, and 4 years after that, recession happened. So that 2008 banking crisis or subprime crisis exposed the weakness of the banking industry in spite of so many regulations. So a lot of people started to think that Basel II accord is not adequate. So regulators themselves now taken a charge and also tried to contribute into Basel norms to identify and establish more and better rules so that such a situation does not happen in the economy again. A Again, the aim was to strengthen the requirements which were there in Basel II on the banks' minimum capital ratios or requirements. The third Basel Accord also aggressively tries to increase the capital which a bank holds. So they might try to increase the tier 1 capital, the amount which they have, it has to be maintained. So such kind of minimum requirements would be raised. Also, they have provided a new concept of capital buffers. So capital buffer would act as a second layer of protection of banks in the event of a extreme crisis. So although they have the minimum capital requirements to capital ratio, apart from that, they might need to maintain capital buffers as well. Some other kinds of buffers also are being suggested, like if there is a credit boom in terms of a bubble which might burst in the future. So to prevent such kind of cycles, there would be additional buffer as well. So there are some additional things or additional precautionary measures which are there in Basel III to prevent a crisis such as which happened in 2008. So norms again were more improved, more provisions were given to the banks. So such kind of preventive measures were suggested or are suggested in Basel III. So now this is the brief history of Basel, how the Basel 1, 2 and 3 accords have come into place.